Well, welcome to St. Mary's. If we haven't met before, my name's Matt. I'm one of the leaders at this church. And today, this is the second talk in a very short two-part series on the gifts of the Spirit. I'm going to be sort of speaking about tongues and prophecy as Paul sort of groups them together and contrasts them. The gift of tongues is perhaps undeniably one of the most contentious gifts mentioned in the New Testament. And so I suppose from the start, we might ask ourselves the question, why are we even going to delve into this topic today? Wouldn't it be more prudent to talk about other things? Things like the character of God or loving our neighbors as ourselves, it would certainly be easier than going into it. And yet it is in fact crucial that we address this topic and other topics like it for a couple of reasons. Firstly, the gifts of the Spirit, as Paul emphasizes, serve to edify, strengthen, and comfort the church. They are vital for our growth and vitality. So with church decline prevalent across most denominations in the UK and the global West, it's noticeable that it's the charismatic and Pentecostal churches that are experiencing growth in the global South, but also in this country, the one denomination in the last 30 years that's seen any growth is the Elam Pentecostals. Perhaps this growth is fueled by the edifying nature of these gifts. Neglecting them jeopardizes our communal and personal spiritual growth. Secondly, much of the discourse surrounding spiritual gifts, particularly tongues, pertains to our corporate times of worship and our practices. Now, in the Church of England and more broadly, the charismatic wing of the church, which we are a part of, is quite rightly facing scrutiny due to misuse and abuses from some leaders. And the response to that shouldn't be to strip the supernatural elements from Christianity. Rather, we must solemnly reflect and address the issues with deep reflection, scriptural grounding, and implementing safeguards. And as the idiom goes, the right response to misuse is not disuse, but proper use. And so it's important that we discuss this, we examine the scriptures, we form a robust theological understanding, and ensure that our practices are in line with the biblical principles. Now, the New Testament only gives a really small snapshot of what church worship and services might have looked in the church's infancy. So breaking bread for one, teaching, prayer, but there isn't much more detail than that. The most detailed description is found in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. It's a very difficult letter to try and summarize because Paul's got no less than 11 things that he's trying to correct this church about. But it does seem to be building to the primary place of disagreement, which is what it means to be spiritual. What it means to be a person of the Spirit. And so Paul begins this section, chapter 12, by telling the church in Corinth, well, you've got to go for a variety of gifts. Just go for as many gifts as you can possibly go. The gifts are good. They're gifts from the Spirit. The Spirit gives them as the Spirit wills, and you must let God be in charge. He does not want the Corinthians to be ignorant about these gifts. He doesn't want them to neglect the gifts. He doesn't want them to be lacking in the gifts. And so go for all of them. Miraculous healings, go for it. Healing, prophecy, faith, discernment, go for all of the gifts, he says. And then he ends the chapter by saying, eagerly desire the greater gifts. And so we, as followers of Jesus Christ, should we do the same? I think we ought to. We shouldn't be ignorant or lacking in them if we're going to take the Bible seriously. We should eagerly desire them, like Paul tells the church in Corinth. Now, the problem is that some people in the Corinthian church seem absolutely fixated on one particular gift over and above all of the other gifts. It's the gift of tongues. They're particularly focused on the gift of tongues. They wear the gift of tongues like a badge of honor, and they look down upon anyone who doesn't seem to be exercising, and they see them as being less spiritual. The logic seems to be that we speak in tongues, the tongues of angels, therefore we've ascended to the apex of our spirituality. We're in fact in the heavenly realms right now, and that means we don't need any of this stuff that Paul's been teaching about. But yeah, resurrection of the body, who cares? The life of the cross, it doesn't really matter, does it? Because we're already there. And actually, we are so full of the spirit of wisdom right now. This Paul guy keeps talking about his weaknesses. He must be less spiritual than us. And so Paul responds in turn. Chapter 13, verse 1. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels and do not have love, I am a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. In other words, if the gifts do not manifest themselves in love, they are worthless. So to summarize, chapter 12, do all the gifts. Chapter 13, do all the love. And then chapter 14, he combines them both, both gifts and love. And this is our main reading for this evening. He begins chapter 14 saying, follow the way of love and eagerly desire the gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. For anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to people, but to God. Indeed, no one understands them. They utter mysteries by the Spirit, but the one who prophesies speaks to people for their strengthening, encouraging, and comfort. Anyone who speaks in a tongue edifies themselves, but the one who prophesies edifies the church. I would like every one of you to speak in tongues, but even more to prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets, so that the church may be edified. If, then, I do not grasp the meaning of what someone is saying, I am a foreigner to the speaker and the speaker a foreigner to me. So it is with you. Since you're eager for the gifts of the Spirit, try to excel in those ones that build up the church. For this reason, the one who speaks in a tongue should pray that they may interpret what they say. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. So what shall I do? Well, I will pray with my spirit and I will pray with my understanding. I will sing with my spirit and I will also sing with my understanding. Otherwise, when you are praising God in the spirit, how can someone else who is now put in the position of an inquirer say, amen, to your thanksgiving, since they do not know what you are saying? You are giving thanks well enough, but no one else is edified. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. I can't understand why no one likes Paul. But in the church, I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct rather than 10,000 words in a tongue. Tongues, then, are a sign, not for believers, but for unbelievers. Prophecy, however, is not for unbelievers, but for believers. And so if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues and an inquirer or unbeliever comes in, will they not say, you are out of your mind? But if an unbeliever or an inquirer comes in while someone is prophesying, they are convicted of sin. They are brought under judgment by all as the secrets of their hearts are laid bare. And so they will fall down and worship God, exclaiming, God is really among you. So, let's have a little look at this. Verse 1, follow the way of love and eagerly desire the gifts of the Spirit. It is both and not either or. Now, in some churches, the gifts become everything. And they are exercised in a manner that those who do are superior to those who do not, just like in the Corinthians. And then in other churches, it's the opposite. They are neglected so that nobody gets upset. Scripturally speaking, we want to go for both. The gifts of the Spirit are precisely that. They are gifts from the Spirit, gifts from the living God to us. Let us not be rude. Let us not reject the things that the big G-O-D wants to give us. Let us follow the way of love and eagerly desire the spiritual gifts, both and. Now, before I continue, let's just talk about the person of the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit works in us. So, those of us who embrace Jesus, the Holy Spirit becomes an indwelling presence in us. Jesus has placed his Holy Spirit in you, and the Spirit's not going anywhere. He's a seal upon your heart. Jesus says the Spirit is like an eternal spring gushing from the depths of our souls. The Spirit is not constrained by the tabernacle. The Spirit is not constrained by the temple. God has left the building, and he's chosen to reside in you. However, our actions can slow the flow or grow the flow of the Spirit. It can slow to a trickle through things that grieve him, like sin, like not believing who he is and reverting to the old ways instead of embracing our new identity. This is what Paul calls giving into the flesh. On the contrary, aligning with the Spirit's desire grows the flow through prayer and worship and being with God's people and just doing spiritual things. It opens the channels for an abundant flow of the Spirit through us. Moreover, the Spirit operates autonomously, weaving through history's tapestry. And so when we come together and we pray simple prayers like, come Holy Spirit, it's like all of our little springs are being gathered together and coming in contact with the enormous rushing stream of God's presence in the room. So Luke's language in Acts, it's like that of a tropical rainstorm. The Holy Spirit drenches the disciples. And this is why some people call the experience of the Spirit like a baptism of the Spirit. It's like they've been utterly drenched. It's not an actual baptism. It's like a baptism. Unlike baptism, which is a once and done event, the experience of the Spirit is something that we can do over and over and over and over again. Be flooded with the Spirit as many times as you like. Paul says in the continuous tense, be filled. Go on being filled by the Spirit over and over and over again. So, church is us coming together with our little springs of water in us, and over there is the raging stream of the Spirit, and we invite the raging stream to come. We worship, we glorify God for who he is, things that he likes. We open ourselves to the Spirit, and he floods us because he's nice, and then he pours out his gifts on his church. Why does he give gifts? He gives out gifts because he loves us. He gives out gifts for the common good, to build up the church which he cares for and loves. And so all the gifts are given so that we might build up one another and strengthen one another, apart from one gift. And the one gift that is not like this is the gift of tongues, which is given to build yourself up. Verse 4, anyone who speaks in a tongue edifies themselves, but one who prophesies edifies the church. This is the one gift given exclusively for you and not for other people. And so imagine you enter the river, God pours out his Spirit, you receive the gift of tongues, and what you're doing is you are speaking back to God. Verse 2, for anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to people, but to God. Indeed, no one understands them, they utter mysteries by the Spirit. And so it's our Spirit communicating with God's Spirit. Tongues is like this precognitive speech. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. And so what the gift of tongues does is it allows us to connect with God without sort of, it kind of takes our brain out of the picture. Now that's not to say that our brains are unimportant, because of course our brains are hugely important. What it really means is to say that our spirits are important, and we need to engage our spirits in order to connect with God. And so if you think about a time when you were extremely happy, or a time when you were really, really sad and there are just no words to express what's happening, no words to express what's happening in your heart, this is kind of how the gift of tongues work. Sometimes our cognitive language just simply cannot express the depth of our feeling, be it in prayer, be it in worship. The gift is given so that we might connect with God. It's like the spirit language that Paul says in Romans 8. It sighs and groans too deep for words. The thing that we need to really grasp here is that these are our sighs and our groans too deep for words. These are our noises that we express. You know, when we don't know how to pray, when we have no words, when we've come to the ends of ourselves because we're in grief or because we're just in adoration and love for God, it's not God taking over us and moving our mouths to say exactly the right words of praise that we wish we could say, but we didn't have the words to say. No, he gives us a gift. He gives us the gift of tongues, sighs and groans, to enable us to express what we simply cannot do with our own cognition, and enabling us to connect with him, the giver of life. And so here we are. We're in the river. We're worshiping. He pours out the gift of tongues, and we speak back to God. And it's like our personal language of worship and prayer to express the inexpressible to him. But it means absolutely nothing to anyone else. Verse 16. Otherwise, when you are praising God in the Spirit, how can someone else who is now put in the position of an inquirer say amen to your thanksgiving, since they do not know what you are saying? You are giving thanks well enough, but no one else is edified. So, you're there worshiping, and you're having a great time. You are loving life. You're praising, you're worshiping. It's all great, because anyone who speaks in a tongue edifies themselves. Tongues is for you. It's good for you. It's good for you. And for that reason alone, I would say don't neglect the gift of tongues. Let me ask you some questions. Do you need encouragement? Do you need to be built up? Is your internal monologue, your self-talk, one of critique? Is it unforgiving? Do you assume that you're always wrong or doubt yourself? Do you find yourself overwhelmed or lost for words? Do you need help with your spiritual life? Is your prayer life feeling quite dry? Is being a Christian really quite hard? Has it always been quite hard? Do you just need some help? Would you not like to go for the thing that God has given you to help you? Tongues builds you up. It's a wonderful, wonderful gift that will transform your worship and prayer in untold ways. Therefore, brothers and sisters, be eager to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues. Do not forbid speaking in tongues, even to yourself. Rather, eagerly desire the gifts of the Spirit. All of them, just eagerly desire them. Now, of course, no one has to speak in tongues. You don't have to. There's no rules about it. You'll be absolutely fine if you don't. Don't feel obligation or pressure, but also know that you can, that there is freedom to do so. There is no sense in the New Testament that tongues are restricted to a particular group of people. This is what it says. So if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues, it kind of suggests that Paul believes that everyone can speak in tongues, even those who've tried and it didn't really happen, or tried and something happened, you're not sure if it's the real thing. Everybody can speak in tongues. Paul says, I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my understanding. I will sing with my spirit, and I will also sing with my understanding. It's both and, not either or. Again, let me ask you this other question. Does your Christianity lean towards understanding, rational-minded, theological? Or does your Christianity lean towards supernatural, spiritual, post-cognitive? I'll do that again. Rational-minded, theological, understanding, supernatural, spiritual, post-cognitive. Which side does your Christianity lean to? Because whichever side is your weaker side, my encouragement to you would be to strengthen that side. Yeah, you're already strong on that side. Why don't you strengthen the other one? Really good at this? Try the other one. Which side do you land on? It will do you good. Very briefly, a few words about prophecy. Verse 3. But the one who prophesies speaks to people for their strengthening, encouraging, and comfort. To prophesy is not to speak to God, but it is to speak to one another. It's to tell other people what we believe God is saying in that moment. It's not future telling. It's not foretelling. It is forth telling. It's bringing God's word into the moment. And the test is it strengthening? Is it encouraging? Is it comforting? I've told this story a million times. I'm going to tell it again. A number of years ago, I was doing the ministry thing, feeling pretty burnt out about it and wondering whether I should be doing it any longer. I head off up to the ministry time, walk up to the front, and as I'm walking to the front, I'm saying, God, I don't know if I'm the right person doing this at the moment. Maybe there's other things that you want me to do. And I open my hands, I close my eyes, and the person comes and lays a hand on my shoulder, prays for me and says, I just feel like the Lord wants to say to you, you're the right person doing the right job at the right time. That's prophecy. Did that pass the test? Yes, it did. It is strengthening, encouraging, and comforting, and praise be to God. I'm glad to be doing the thing that God has called me to do. So, that's tongues, that's prophecy, that's the gifts. Let's also look at the way of love that Paul tells the Corinthians to follow. So, the problem appears to be in Corinth that the church gatherings have become about speaking in tongues and everybody speaking from the front, one by one, with no interpretation whatsoever. So, you know, like we do, we invite people up after the worship to come and share stories or prophetic words, little round of applause, very little round of applause. Then they go and sit down, then the next person comes up. Imagine that, but people coming up to the front, babbling down the microphone, little round of applause, go and sit down, back up, babble down the microphone. Nobody knows what's going on whatsoever. This would happen the whole time. And this is a problem for Paul. It's a problem for Paul because it shows a lack of love. So if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues and inquirers or unbelievers come in, will they not say you are out of your mind? But if an unbeliever or an inquirer comes in while everyone is prophesying, they are convicted of sin and are brought under judgment by all as the secrets of their heart are laid bare. So they will fall down and worship God, exclaiming, God is really among you. The lack of love problem for Paul is twofold. Firstly, if everybody speaks in tongues, they are only building themselves up and they're not building anyone else up. Two, if unbelievers walk through the door, they will not understand what's going on because everybody's just babbling. They will think that everyone's gone absolutely cray-cray, which they haven't. They're in the presence of God, but the unbelievers will misunderstand and they will dismiss the whole church thing. And this shows a lack of love to those outside the church. Two obvious follow-up points from this. Paul assumes that unbelievers will be present in our church gatherings. Church is not and should not be a closed shop to anyone. It has to be a place where anyone, regardless of belief or lifestyle, can come in, be welcome, and they can hang out at the back as long as they like, just watching what's going on. You are here on your own terms, as we so often say here. Now, if you then decide to follow Jesus, good idea, it may be then that actually you aren't here on your own terms, but you're actually here on his terms. He may decide to change you if you let him. You don't have to. It's a good idea. And so the church has to be a place where non-Christians can come in and everything we do needs to acknowledge that they don't believe or understand what we're talking about. And so we need to explain it. And so if you've come from other churches and come to this church, you may have noticed that we explain the words of knowledge or the prophecy thing or the tongues thing before thing. We break the worship. It's very disruptive. I know it's annoying and I know it's different from other places. This is our way that we try to show love to people on the outside. If you've been here, you could basically recite what I say all the time because you've heard it enough times. It's not for you. It's the way we show love to people on the outside. Second point. Paul does not have an issue with spirit-filled gatherings. He wants them. His problem is not the gift of tongues. Paul says, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. His problem is that tongues are the only gift that people seem to care about and that they are being expressed without interpretation or explanation. And so in our gathered worship times, the service leader or the worship leader may encourage people to sing in tongues by themselves at the end of worship. It's not done up the front. It's just between you and God where you are sat. Sometimes it's appropriate to ask those who are confident speaking in tongues to speak out louder, to offer a bit of a covering, not to dominate, to offer a covering over those who are less confident or just trying out. And I think Paul would be totally fine with that. What we're not doing is inviting people up to come and give a loud tongue from the front and then not interpreting and sending them back down to their seat. So, having said all of that, Paul much prefers prophecy in public settings because it will not fail the love test. It builds everyone up, it's easily understood by outsiders, and it can be so powerful that they walk in from the outside and immediately bow down and worship. So, how then are we to make sense of verse 22 that says, tongues then are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers. Prophecy, however, is not for unbelievers, but for believers. Given what Paul has just said, wouldn't we expect the opposite, that tongues are a sign for believers and prophecy a sign for unbelievers? Well, the way to understand this is that the sign that Paul is talking about is a sign of whether someone has come to recognize the Spirit of God or not. And so tongues are a sign for unbelievers, not believers, in that they are a sign that unbelievers have not recognized the Spirit of God. And it's not their fault. As Paul has said, the church should not be putting unbelievers in this position at all. But tongues do signify to the unbeliever they have not recognized the Spirit because they mistake who the Spirit is, because speaking in tongues means they just think these people must be out of their minds, which is not the case. It's God's presence with them. Likewise, prophecy is a sign for the unbeliever. When the unbeliever hear prophecy, they may then bow down and worship God, which is a sign to believers. Because we go, oh my goodness, God's real. I completely forgot. This is amazing. He's even talking to unbelievers. It's a sign to them. So, to end, given that we are neither to neglect love nor the gifts, how do we prophesy and use the gift of tongues for the common good in our corporate worship settings like this? Let's begin with prophecy. With prophecy, it must be in line with what God has said about himself and the world and us. It has to be biblical. No, God has not told you that murder is great. And he hasn't told you that lust is fine. And he hasn't told you that Jesus is coming back next Tuesday. Two, the church gets to decide if the prophecy is correct or what God is saying, not the person giving the prophecy. So Paul says two or three prophets should speak, and then the others should weigh carefully what is said. The job of the prophet is to say what they think God is saying. They're like postal workers. They post the letter, they put it through the box, and it's for the other person to read. And so we, on the other side, are actually trying to work out whether this is right or not. Now, in my experience, when you hear people give prophetic words here at the front, you kind of know if it's right. You know if you know. Sometimes the prophetic word is said and it's like, oh my gosh, that was so for me. You just know. And if you don't know, don't worry. Just leave it. And if you hear it and you think, oh, I don't know, maybe, don't worry. Don't worry. But don't let non-prophesying stop us. Eagerly desire the gifts, particularly prophecy. And by the way, two or three prophets, it's a pragmatic suggestion. It's not a law. Paul does not write laws. He writes letters. And so if 20 prophecies come up in a service, we'll just struggle to remember what's been said. So if you've got two or three, it's just easier to remember. In fact, I love it. I love it when two or three people come up to the front off their prophetic words and they say the same sort of thing, or they pick up on a theme and they say it in slightly different ways. And so if you have got a word and you're sat in your seat and other people are sharing words and somebody says something that you were kind of thinking as well, you should not be thinking, oh, good, that's been said. You should think, oh, I had the same thing. I should share that because that will confirm it. That will show that the sign, that will confirm the sign for other people as well. And it will strengthen our sense that God is speaking to us and that he's with us. Thirdly, you do not need to prophesy, even if you feel really strongly that God has spoken to you. Verse 32, the spirits of the prophets are subject to the control of prophets, for God is not a God of disorder, but of peace. You are in control. You're in control, as often is the case. You are in control. The issue for the prophetic person is not hearing God speak. It's knowing when and how and if to share that prophetic word with anyone. Learn. Learn when to prophesy and when it is appropriate to do so. However, if you're new to prophecy, completely disregard that last point. You should be using your gift, exercising and strengthening that muscle. How on earth did you learn to play the guitar or drive a car or anything else like that? By trying and making mistakes. This is your safe space in order to give it a go. We will tell you if you are making mistakes and need to stop making mistakes. And we'll do it in a really nice way. But it's much better if you give it a go. Much better to make some mistakes along the way than to never do anything at all. Now, tongues. There are relatively rare instances where tongues aren't just singing and praying and worshiping to God on our own or in a group. But occasionally, everyone hears a public tongue. And this usually happens after an intense spirit-filled time of worship. Everyone's worshiping, everyone's caught up in wonder, love and praise, and then suddenly somebody loudly sings out a public tongue. This is in no way prohibited. In fact, it should be encouraged. However, when this happens, an interpretation needs to come because otherwise it means absolutely nothing to anyone in the room, okay? Often, the person who is given that particular tongue is the best person to interpret it because their cognitive mind can make sense of and interpret what their spirit has said. And Paul encourages this. But sometimes it could be someone else. It doesn't have to be. What tongues are, though, is not prophecy. Tongues are tongues, and prophecy is prophecy. So tongues is about speaking to God. And so a public interpretation of a tongue will be things like worship and prayer and something that you might say to God. It might be like, I love you, God. It's worship. Or bring your kingdom here. Or fill this place with your presence. Or God, we are grieving a lack of your justice in the world. It is prayer. It is worship. It is praise. It is not prophecy. So, to that end, I'd like to say that we all get to play. Every single one of us gets to play if we would like to. And I'd like to offer you with a little bit of a challenge for every time you come to church on a Sunday. And I'd like to ask you a few questions just you might reflect on as you come to church. First one, how can I be used in these services? That's a great question to come to church with. How can God speak to me today? What gifts does he want to gift me so I can build up his church? How can I edify and love the church while I'm here? And do you know what? When we start doing that and asking those questions and coming with that sort of expectation, church becomes really fun. Like really fun. Really, really exciting. It stops being like, I don't like this song very much. Matt speaking again. Serene. No, we love Serene. It becomes fun when we do this. Do you know why? Because we are participating in stuff that can actually set people free. You can bring a word into this context that can change somebody's life forever. Let's not settle for boring church where we're just sort of playing a bit. This is how we grow as Christians, as individuals, as a church. And I guess even further from going back to my starting point, this is how the church doesn't die. It's by engaging in these things that edify us and edify one another. So, verse 26. What then shall we say, brothers and sisters? When you come together, each of you has a hymn or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue or an interpretation. Everything must be done so that the church may be built up. So, let us do that. Let us be Bible-believing Christians who follow the way of love and eagerly desire the spiritual gifts.